Welcome to Spotlight on Migraine, hosted by the Association of Migraine Disorders. Join us for fresh perspectives by medical experts and advocates as we explore the spectrum of migraine and dig deeper into this complex disease.
Hello and welcome to Spotlight on Migraine. I'm your host, Molly O'Brien. Today, we're diving into the topic of how migraine can turn chronic. And to dive into this topic with us is VP of Neurology at Lundbeck Pharmaceutical, Dr. Roger Cady. Dr. Cady, thanks so much for joining us today.
Well, I'm glad to be here, Molly, and thank you for inviting me.
We're very excited to have you here, and you've been involved in the migraine and headache world for quite some time, so we're looking forward to getting your insight.
Yeah, well, you can see with all the gray hair, I'm for a while, yes.
You're an expert. We'll say it like that. All right, so I'm super interested in this topic. I personally have migraine. I've had it my whole life, but turned chronic in my 20s, and didn't really know that you turned chronic and why it happened. So I think a lot of people are out there are curious about this issue. So we'll start off with a very basic question. Why do some people transition from occasional or acute migraine into chronic migraine?
Well, the bottom line for this is that migraine is a very dynamic disease. And I'm sure in your own experience, you realize that there are good months and bad months, and they're depending on what's going on in your life and other things, you can have more frequent or less frequent migraine. So, you know, I think that's a big part of that answer. And then the other thing is that people who have migraine sort of inherit a nervous system that is unique to people that don't have migraine. And, you know, you see that in the fact that, you know, family histories are very common. Many people have another family member with migraine, or if you have two parents with migraine, odds are you're going to have migraine more than if you have one or have no parents with it. So, you know, there's this sort of genetic predisposition that makes certain people susceptible to changes in their environment. And part of the reason, or a major part of the reason, that people go back and forth and transition from episodic to chronic is that they're responding to different changes in their life at different times.
It's always interesting to note that, you know, some people will ask, well, why do you have migraine right now? Why do you have an attack? Well, I don't know. And it's nothing I did. A lot of the time, that's the case.
Yeah, Molly, that is so, so important. You know, migraine is not a disease people should be blamed for. And unfortunately, in the past, that sometimes happened. But, you know, this is a very biologic disorder. And we understand it that way today. You know, healthcare professionals and people who work in the field of migraine. And this is as biologic as is diabetes or hypertension or any other chronic disorder.
Our next question is, if someone is living with chronic migraine, is there any hope or chance, I guess would be a good way to put it, any chance that they could transition back into having occasional or acute migraine?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, I talked about this a moment ago that, you know, in life, even with and without treatment, people transition from more frequent migraine to less frequent migraine. And there's actually a pretty large population of people who kind of are on that threshold between episodic and chronic migraine and move back and forth quite commonly. But I think you're also asking another important question. If people get in and sort of stuck in that chronic migraine, can they be get back into a much more manageable pattern of migraine? And here again, the answer is yes. There are lots of causes or things that relate to people getting caught in chronic migraine. There's lots of solutions that we can provide. And the most important solution in my mind is to make this transition from seeing migraine as a disease that you treat attack by attack with acute medicine to one that you manage on a day-to-day basis by protecting the nervous system and preventing migraine from occurring as frequently as it does maybe today. So it's really, you know, when people start with migraine, they're often thinking about, well, I need medicine when I have an attack. But when it starts to become frequent, you need to think about protecting that nervous system and preventing migraine. So preventative therapies start to take the forefront.
You mentioned medication just now. I'm wondering, is there any role that medication has from someone transitioning from episodic migraine to chronic migraine?
Yes, it's a very important thing for all people with migraine to understand. because medication is one of the most frequent reasons that people do get trapped and stuck in this cycle of chronic migraine. And it kind of works two ways. You know, one of them is when people are over-reliant on their acute medicine to treat frequent migraine, it's easy to want to take more medicine because you're having more migraine. And so when in doing that, very often people start to find that their medication isn't working quite as well as it used to. And again, they're taking more and more of that medication. And so in the end, when they're using very frequent medication, the medication itself can actually transform the headache, and a new headache can emerge and coexist with migraine, especially chronic migraine, and that's called the medication overuse headache, or MOH. It's a name I don't really like, by the way, but it's what we're stuck with in our nomenclature today. But anyway, it's really where the medication is actually starting to maintain the headache. So the big thing with medicine is you need medicine that is effective and actually doing what it's expected to do and what you as a patient would be expecting it to do. And then the other is to provide medication that transition from this treat the attack to prevent the attack. So the preventive medications.
And thank you for that. Yeah, sometimes it's tough to keep up with all the vernacular, making sure we have the right terms, but you seem like you know. It's tough for me to keep up sometimes. Oh, that changed.
Yeah.
So we talked a little bit about medication just now. I'm wondering, is there anything that people can do to mitigate their chronic migraine? I know you said kind of having those medications that we need, but what else can people do to mitigate chronic migraine?
Well, you know, I think in migraine and to manage migraine well, you really need to be proactive and you really need to be an advocate for yourself. And so I'm a big proponent of that. And that starts with probably education, learning about not only the disease and what you find in the textbooks and articles and things like that, but understanding yourself and how your unique biology fits into the world in which you live. And, you know, starting to make and be part of the decision-making process around this. I think it's very important that you forge a relationship with a healthcare professional and actually probably a larger team of headache allies. That could be, you know, best friends, spouses, people who have also shared this disease and maybe have ideas on how they've managed it successfully. So you create kind of a team around all of that. And, you know, the other thing about this is I think it's important to keep track of your migraine, keep a diary. Look not only for the things that seem to cause or associate with migraine, but also about those days where things go well. What happened on those days that, you know, made you successful with the environment? And I think you can learn a lot around that. And I think, you know, the other important thing is to frequently do an inventory with yourself and literally say, you know, am I getting the results that I really am looking for? And honestly, not settle for this idea that, you know, good enough is good enough. So, you know, that you're not really good, but you're able to survive and get by. And I think one of the most important questions that people can ask themselves is, how many days a month am I actually free from migraine? Do I have good days? And if you're not happy with that answer, well, then I think it's time to kind of reflect and reevaluate your migraine management program.
Such a good way to look at that, to take inventory, right? We are our own best advocates, like you mentioned, but to take inventory of what's going well, what's not going well. But I think sometimes when you're in such a loop of pain, it gets hard to remember those days that are good. So I think taking inventory is good. Another point you mentioned was having a team of people on your side, you know, not just your providers, but other people. And I kind of liken that to, you know, we talk about migraine toolbox a lot, right? Like what are the tools we need? So it's like a toolbox of people. And I love that concept. You need people around you to lift you up and to build you up and be on your side.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's so important. And these are partnering relationships. We all participate in that. And of course, it's at the center is the person with migraine. But as you know, migraine has so many facets and spokes that work out. So I think family members can be part of this, your social circles can be part of this. And of course, your healthcare team can be part of this.
So going back to how chronic migraine works, is there a reason that only some people transition to chronic migraine, or does it kind of tie into those environmental factors and genetic factors that we can't pinpoint it yet?
Yeah, well, I think ultimately it does tie into those genetic factors and the environment. And, you know, we can't all avoid all of the things in life that can provoke migraine. And I think that's an important thing to understand. But, you know, we're just learning about this. And what we are learning is that this process of chronification, or going from a more episodic pattern of migraine, where migraine has a beginning and an end, to one where migraine just begins to merge together and the headaches are always there to some degree, or the effects of those headaches are always there. And one of the things that we're learning is that the nerves that are activated and cause migraine, when repeatedly activated over and over again, the threshold to activate them the next time gets lower and lower and lower, and eventually can reach a point where it almost takes nothing to cause your next migraine. You know, a change in the weather, boom, I got a migraine. And yeah, you've probably experienced that. And, you know, it's this type of sensitization, or neuronal sensitization, as it's called, that is probably at the heart of the physiology of chronic migraine. And so, you know, I kind of liken this with patients of talking about putting the insulation back on the nerves, you know, and that comes with a lot of different ways. I mean, you can do it with certain things in your lifestyle and managing your environment, not as a saint or perfectly, but, you know, more acceptable to you and more successful for you. And it can happen by getting your acute medications tuned up, so you're taking them at a proper time, ones that actually work well for you. And importantly, we're learning this early addition of prevention. And that's not all of medicine. That can be things with lifestyle and biofeedback, relaxation techniques. And I always point out to my patients, making sure you have time for recreation every day. That's how the nervous system, you know, gets its balance. So that's an important thing to consider and track in your diaries and in your records.
I love that. I'm curious if, in your years working within the industry and being a doctor, if you've seen an emergence of more chronic migraine and what you might attribute that to. Is it just simply we're knowing more about it, or if more people are transitioning?
Yeah, well, you know, that's a superb question, to be honest. As you're probably well aware, there's about 39 million people in the United States alone with migraine. And of that population, about 4 million are estimated to have chronic migraine. So that's 10% of people at any one point in time. If you kind of looked at this over a lifetime, it's going to be a much larger percent that at some point would evolve into chronic migraine. I think to get back to your question, though, the reason that we probably see chronic migraine is, first of all, we're looking for it. It's being diagnosed. People don't realize that we didn't have a diagnosis of chronic migraine until 2004.
Oh, wow.
And I would argue that we probably didn't have a really good diagnosed definition of it until maybe 2016, or the most recent at 2018. So this is a relatively new concept for physicians to understand. Mm. When I started in migraine, it was looked at as a self-limited disorder that would go away no matter what you did, and people return back to normal. And now we find when migraine is frequent enough, that is definitely not true. You know, that the effects of migraine can linger between migraines and worsen over time if migraine is not well controlled or well managed. So I think those are probably important reasons. And then one could argue, you know, and we saw this during the COVID pandemic, you know, when we have major stress in our lives, permeating our lives, it's more likely for migraine to transform from that episodic into a more chronic form.
Fascinating to learn this and to learn a little bit about the history and how our knowledge has grown and changed over the years.
Oh, that's so true. Just so absolutely true.
And Dr. Cady, as we wrap up here, I'm wondering if there's anything else you want to share with our audience about migraine in general or about chronic migraine, stuff that you just want people to make sure they know.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm always kind of careful to call migraine a disorder, a condition when it's infrequent. When people are having one or two migraine, it, of course, those attacks can be very disabling, but people do recover and there's plenty of time to recover between attacks. But it has this curious ability, if you will, to really transform into a disease. And that's an important thing for people who have this sensitivity, if you will, or the genetic influences that lead to migraine, for them to understand that, you know, when migraine becomes frequent, it permeates every aspect of your life. And it's not just your personal life, it's family, it's friends, it's your work environment. And, you know, we really need to understand that this is, in fact, or has the potential to be a chronic disease. And the other most important thing that I want to leave everybody with is it's just treatable. In fact, I would argue that migraine is one of the most treatable chronic diseases. And, you know, people aren't broken who have migraine. They kind of need a tune-up, I think, very often. But they're certainly not broken.
I love that analogy. And I think just by saying that, you offer some hope, right? And that is wrapping up this episode of Spotlight on Migraine. I'd like to say thank you to our guest today, Dr. Roger Cady. Thank you for helping us get a little bit more insight on how chronic migraine goes on. We appreciate your time.
Well, Molly, it was enjoyable, and I really appreciate the opportunity to have this. And for all your listeners who live with migraine or know someone who lives with migraine, I wish them all the success in the world. Thank you.
We really do appreciate that. And we appreciate you watching or listening out there. Big thank you to all of our followers. That wraps up this episode of Spotlight on Migraine. For the Association of Migraine Disorders, I'm your host, Molly O'Brien.
Thank you for tuning into Spotlight on Migraine. For more information on migraine disease, please visit migrainedisorders.org.